this panel will be a little more creative linguistically. We are under the, of course, tyranny of the lingua franca English. Our speaker from Ukraine has given us a text which we have translated into English. It'll be read by Marta Baziuk. We do this largely because to do a simultaneous translation will take up a lot of time, and I think this will be better for our discussion. And then I may have to help Dr. Hrynevych a little bit in the question period, but I'm sure that we will all come together closer through these discussions. Okay, for those of you who know Ukrainian, we have 20 copies of the original text in Ukrainian. Anyone who would like the Ukrainian text? Yes, okay, very good, okay, yes. Marko, let's take it. Okay, so anyone who would like the Ukrainian text, you can read along in the original. I ask all of those who you know Ukrainian, please to be tolerant later from any of the question periods when I make mistakes, as I inevitably will if I help with the translation. But you all know that problem of having those native speakers around when you're trying to do the translations. Okay, Bohdan.
Okay, thank you. My name is Bohdan Klid. I'm with the Canadian Institute of Ukrainian Studies and also the research director of the Holodomor Research and Education Consortium. Okay. The name is Bohdan Klid. I'm with the Canadian Institute of Ukrainian Studies at the University of Alberta and also the research director at the Holodomor Research and Education Consortium. And I'm the chair of the session coming up right now. And I'd like to introduce the speaker at this point, who is Liudmyla Hrynevych, whose paper will be read by Marta Baziuk, the director of HREC. Liudmyla Hrynevych is a senior research associate at the Institute of History of the Ukrainian National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine. She has many articles. She's also our colleague in HREC, and also she's the director of the Holodomor Research and Education Center in Kyiv, which is a separate organization, but which is affiliated with our consortium here in Canada. Now, she has many publications related to the famine and other topics, but I want to point out her two most recent publications. She's the author of the Famine of 1928-29, The Authorities and Society, which came out in 2014 or 2015. I don't quite remember which year it was, but very recent publication. And it's really important to understand that famine in the context of what happened in 1932-33. She's also the author of a number of volumes in a long-term project. The first volume in three books, which is called The Chronicle of Collectivization and the Holodomor in Ukraine, 1927-1933. The first volume covers the years 1927 through December 1927 through the middle of 1929. And the second volume just came out a couple of months ago, is the first book of volume two, covers the period from the summer of 1929 to the beginning of 1930. And this is the third volume will cover the years of the famine itself. Liudmyla will be will not be speaking now, but will be her paper will in English translation will be read by Marta Baziuk, and the commentator today is Mark von Hagen, who's a professor at the School of International Letters and Cultures at the Arizona State University, and he's first came to my attention, at least in 1992, with the publication of a very provocatively titled article called "Does Ukraine Have a History?" in which he gave some ideas on how the history of Ukraine could be written, And his current research project is the publication of a translation of Pavlo Krystyuk's notes and materials on the Ukrainian Revolution, which, and Pavlo Krystyuk was a Ukrainian SR politician who became a member of the Ukrainian government in 1917-18, and he wrote his observations and included many original documents in a publication that Mark will be, writing an introduction and commenting on, and it's very important in the light of the centenary of the revolution coming up next year to bring attention to this aspect of the Ukrainian revolution in the context of the overall Russian and East European revolution that took place in those years. So if I could ask Marta Basiuk now to read Dr. Hrynevych's paper.
Good afternoon. Please tell me if I need to speak any more loudly. It's my honor and privilege to read this text written by Liudmyla Hrynevych, perhaps the leading scholar of the Holodomor in Ukraine. I'd also like to acknowledge Professor Taras Koznarski for his translation of this text. Over the last 30 years, from the time of the opening of the Soviet archives at the end of the 1980s, our knowledge and understanding of the causes and specifics of the Ukrainian famine of 1933 that resulted from a faminogenic state policy, a term coined by the legal scholar David Marcus, have significantly increased. We now have a strong basis for examining the Ukrainian famine in broad historic and comparative contexts, and there has certainly been progress in this direction. However, the Ukrainian famine is most often seen through the prism of communism, totalitarianism, and genocide. The discourse of imperialism and colonialism remains marginal to the intellectual discussion about the Holodomor. The 19th and 20th centuries are marked by numerous examples of famine-making policies conducted by empires in their colonies. The scale of these crimes is so substantial, so shocking, that Mike Davis provocatively called his study Late Victorian Holocausts. We have in mind here famines in India, China, Africa, as well as in Ireland. Looking at why the context of empire and famine have not been applied to the Ukrainian case, we can see that the reasons only partially lie in the scholarly sphere. I am convinced that political and psychological factors play a larger role. A long-standing tradition has developed since the time of the Cold War of using the terms Soviet empire, red imperialism, and Soviet colonial practices for political purposes. This has created an environment in which it is taken as a sign of serious scholarship to distance oneself from even the simple posing of the problem imperialism, colonialism, and the Ukrainian famine. This is especially true about Western scholars. Professor Olga Andreevsky pointed to this problem a few years ago at a conference organized by this same organization, the Holodomor Research and Education Consortium, and a question that she posed to Professor Mark von Hagen. In fact, his authoritative and politically provocative answer, calling the Ukrainian famine the highest stage of imperialism, marked the start of an intellectual discussion of which this conference is a continuation and which we plan to continue in a conference in Kyiv in 2017. Collectivization under Stalin and the Holodomor of 32-33 are justly considered central themes in Ukrainian history of the 20th century, in which the problems of Russian-Soviet imperialism, colonialism, Stalinist totalitarianism, and genocide converge. I would assert the following. In grasping the nature and effects of the Ukrainian Holodomor, we must realize that at the root of the famine-making policies of Soviet authorities were ideas central to Marxist theory and communist practice. That is, rejection of private property, class struggle as the engine of progress, developed as a theory of inevitable intensification of class struggle in the building of socialism, militant atheism, and proletarian internationalism as the antithesis of bourgeois national patriotism. On the other hand, in the Ukrainian reality during the Stalinist revolution from above, the pressure from the center common to all regions of the USSR was intensified and in certain important moments defined by the vertical. It is not only possible, but necessary, to view this dynamic through the prism of imperial and colonial discourses. The distinctive features of the political structure of empire are such that the central expansionist regions dominate over national peripheries and are able to control and exploit the economic resources of the latter. Hence, an examination of the tragedy in Ukraine in 1932-33 from the perspective of imperial and colonial studies invites, first of all, analysis of the economic relations between the Soviet center and the Ukrainian periphery. I'd like to point out that Vladimir Lenin in 1914 himself drew attention to Russia's economic colonialism in Ukraine. In a speech he made in Switzerland, Lenin noted that Ukraine had become for Russia what Ireland was to England, and he said, sucking everything from it and giving nothing in return. After the Bolsheviks came to power, Lenin never mentioned this parallel again, and his Swiss speech was never cited nor published in the Soviet Union. Ukrainian Marxists, as Stepan Velichenko has noted, from the time the Bolsheviks took power, clearly saw the threat of Russian imperialism. They asserted that without the economic independence of the Soviet republics, their political independence was impossible. And Vasil Shakhrai and Serhiy Mazlakh wrote about this. Nobel laureate Amartya Sen, in his work Poverty and Famines, an essay on entitlement and deprivation, formulated the important thought that famine is first and foremost connected to human factors, and above all, the unfair distribution of property and the market. Building on his formulation of the main causes of famine, we can observe that in the case of the Ukrainian Holodomor, not only the peasant farmers, but the entire republic was forced to serve as the granary of the Soviet state. While it was formally equal with other republics with its own government and declarative rights, the Ukrainian Republic found itself at the end of the 20s and beginning of the 1930s in a critical situation. It was unable to administer its own grain resources to the extent necessary to avoid the death of its population from starvation. Let us now survey the most telling moments in the colonial policies of the Kremlin. In 1928, Soviet economist Mikhailo Volobuyev defined Ukraine as a colony of the European type, stressing that industrially developed Ukraine was deprived not only of resources, as was the case in colonies in Asia, but also of its capital and potential profits. In the opinion of Volobuyev, the central Soviet government was responsible, which through its imperial policies of price formation, transferred capital from Ukraine and created a situation in which the price of Russian finished products was unusually high, while the price for Ukrainian raw materials remained low. Hence, capital was accumulated in the Russian north and not in the Ukrainian south. In the context of the first five-year plan, in spite of the economic interests of the Ukrainian Republic, Moscow did not allow it to diversify agricultural production and rejected proposals to somewhat decrease grain production and develop livestock. Instead, the Ukrainian Socialist Soviet Republic was forced to specialize in grain production, with agricultural production oriented to providing the northern regions, that is Russia, with grain. These tendencies intensified and became one of the reasons the grain market in Ukraine collapsed at the start of the 30s. On November 26, 1928, in Kharkiv, the fourth All-Soviet Council of Agriculture took place. The fact that this meeting took place in what was then the Ukrainian capital was announced by M. Kubyak, Minister of Agriculture for the Russian Republic and member of the All-Soviet Executive Committee. And he said it was a response, quote, to lies in the bourgeois press that in the Soviet Union, equality of the peoples doesn't exist and that Moscow rules all. In reality, the Council announced the following strategies. First, to maintain for the next decade grain production as the main branch of Ukrainian agriculture. The delegation to the All-Soviet Planning Committee the authority to determine, quote, the grain balance of certain regions, and the determination to which regions, quote, grain was to be delivered, and the regions that were to solve their own food needs. In fact, these strategies did not at all counter the bourgeois lies about the key role of Moscow in making vitally important decisions for the republics. On the contrary, they proved Volobuyev's conclusion that, quote, the essence of colonial dependence for a colony of the European type lies in the deformation of the development of productive forces in favor of the metropolitan economy. It is symbolic that at this time, this same Mikhailo Volobuyev, the economist who opposed the colonial prism for Ukraine. He published a letter in the journal Bolshevik of Ukraine, in which he repented, disavowing his earlier nationalist mistakes. And in this published letter, he advanced new theses, among which was the idea that the only correct view was based on principles of brotherly cooperation of nationally diverse proletarian cultures and socialist branches of economies of the national republics. An illustrative example is the case of the shareholding concern Ukrainsky Khlib, Ukraine Bread. Ukraine Bread was absorbed by the center, which created in its stead Soyuz Khlib, Soviet Union Bread. The subordination of the Ukrainian bread market to the all-Soviet center under the guise of rationalization of the grain production and distribution apparatus became an important event in the spring and summer of 1928. This de facto not only deprived the Ukrainian SSSR of its share of capital, but also of real levers of influence on the grain market. A clear tendency was emerging. The Soviet center was becoming the sole administrator of Ukrainian grain. Mike Davis has pointed to the capacity of the British Empire to gain advantage from famine via expansion of the liberal market in the colonies, which was carried out by the destruction of local institutions and potential competition. This practice could be said to be similar to Moscow's liquidation of Ukraine Bread and its transfer of capital to Russia. It was precisely by depriving authorities in Ukraine of the right to manage Ukrainian grain that a situation was created in 1932-33 when grain located on Ukrainian territory, stored in Ukrainian grain elevators by Ukrainian farmers, became inaccessible to the starving. Ukrainian authorities could not manage the grain because it was no longer the Republic's, but was Moscow's. Let us now turn to the topic of the exploitation of Ukrainian resources to the advantage of Moscow. In 1927-28 through 1932-33, the plans for Ukraine to deliver grain were reviewed continuously by Moscow in a one-sided fashion, each time with the demands for grain increasing. Massive extraction of grain resources from the Ukrainian SSR obviously was carried out by Stalinist authorities to alleviate the grain crisis in the Soviet Union and also to prevent political destabilization in Moscow and Leningrad. However, this extraction was carried out by force, by a system of administrative pressure on the entire vertical of the Ukrainian authorities and farmers, and most important, at the expense of the needs of the Ukrainian population. The party leadership and government of the Ukrainian SSR in 1923-33 protested repeatedly against the unreasonably impossible high demands of the plan to extract grain, warning Moscow of the negative consequences. But the central government forced the dependent Ukrainian Republican government to maintain party discipline and carry out the strategy, quote, of maximal mobilization of resources in Ukraine, end of quote. Ukrainian grain obviously alleviated a bread crisis in the USSR. The cost was the collapse of the Ukrainian grain market in 1928-29, the appropriation of the last grain reserves of the Ukrainian farmers, and, of course, the massive famine that ensued in 1932-33. The analysis of the deliveries of grain from Ukraine within the Soviet Union in 28-29, when famine loomed, proves that 130 million poods of grain were removed by force from the territory of an exhausted Ukraine and caused the earlier famine, the 1928 and 29 famine. However, we now compare it to the grain distribution within the Soviet Union in the time just before the Holodomor of 1932-1933. This has not been studied, and Gennady Boryak has written about the issue of archive destruction. He has pointed out that documents concerning 1932-1933 were destroyed at the beginning of World War II. I have carefully studied archival registries of documents which could have illuminated the question of how much grain was taken from Ukraine in 32 and sent to the other republics, in particular to Russia. What I have found is that in the 1960s, there was a political ideological house cleaning of politically sensitive documents carried out and materials illuminating the full picture of the extraction of Ukrainian grain then sent on to Russia were intentionally removed from the Ukrainian archives. Maybe they were destroyed, although there is the possibility that they can still be found and studied. Grain export from the territory suffering from famine is a classic example of colonial policy. In British colonies of the 19th century, first of all India, as pointed out in Mike Davis's book, Britain used foodstuffs at the time when millions used the export of foodstuffs at the time when millions were dying from famine. Between 1875 and 1900, a period during which worst famines in the history of India occurred, the annual export of grain increased from 3 million to 10 million tons. Irish potatoes were exported as livestock feed at a time when the country was in the grip of famine. The scale of both direct and indirect food export from Ireland is striking. The territories suffering from famines were supplying more than 80% of some foodstuffs to British cities and towns. I would like to mention the little researched topic of non-grain exports. The list of so-called secondary products exported abroad during the Ukrainian Holodomor is striking. Exports of foodstuffs during the Holodomor demonstrate that military industrial modernization remained top priorities of the Soviet government, even at the time of the most serious food crisis. The topic of state support and relief from famine deserves particular attention. In 1928-29, all Soviet Republican cooperation in establishing a strategy for state support to those suffering from famine took place in the context of a government relief commission. That was about 1928-29. However, the activities of this commission during the famine indicate that the sending of grain from Soviet republics to the territories where people were suffering in Ukraine, that is relief, while relief was being sent, at the same time, there was export from Ukraine in the opposite direction of nearly the same amount of Ukrainian grain as was being brought in as famine relief. During this time, the formula of famine relief outlined by the sociologist Sorokin was violated, according to which on the territories that suffer, groups consuming food should be in control of managing the import of food to their territory. It is telling that in the Holodomor, the much more drastic famine of 1932-33, no such relief commission was ever created. However, in the spring of 33, a certain amount of grain was finally brought into Ukraine to feed the collective farm members in order for them to be able to continue to work the harvest. The question arises, wasn't this just the return to Ukraine of a small fraction of its food reserves that had already been confiscated in 1932? The ideological and propagandist context of the Ukrainian catastrophe can be compared to colonial policies and practices of Europeans in Africa, Asia, and the British in Ireland. I have in mind the conviction that the imperial forces were bringing civilization to a barbaric country. The classic works of Ambarajan, Classical Political Economy and British Policy in India, about the attitudes of the British establishment regarding the Indian famines in the 19th century, leaves no doubt that ideology of state bureaucracy infused with a racist colonial Malthusian spirit negatively contributed to the impact of the massive famine. If British propaganda depicted the Irish and the Indian populations as dirty and uncivilized, the Bolsheviks hid the national aspect behind the notion of class. In their propaganda, Russian culture was advanced as progressive and revolutionary and destined to overcome a regressive, outdated peasant Ukrainian culture with its anachronistic traditions, including its music, such as the national instrument, the bandura, and its language, the language of the Ukrainian peasant. One should also draw attention to the attempts of Soviet propaganda to find culprits among the categories of the population viewed as potentially antagonistic to Soviet authority. In the context of genocide studies, the analysis of the dehumanization of the perceived enemy in Soviet political propaganda is especially productive. By constructing the dehumanizing image of the Kirkul, that is the rich Ukrainian peasant, as a parasite and enemy during the famine, authorities prepared the population for the destruction of an entire social class. And then we must add to this the additional tag often added on, petdurite, which is an indicator of a supporter of the Ukrainian national movement during the revolution of 1917-1919, and a way of labeling someone a dangerous nationalist. During the famine, much depended on the actions of local nomenklatura and those sent from Moscow. A certain portion of them had anti-Ukrainian inclinations. A significant portion did not use or know the Ukrainian language. But those who were themselves Ukrainian and used the language were nonetheless gripped by the fear of being declared nationalists, the purges of which were a regular occurrence. These factors could not but influence the attitudes of party and government functionaries toward the famine-making policies of the central authorities. We should also study the question of whether Bolshevik policies of cadre building can be categorized as colonial in nature. The impact of the famine cannot be overstated. Not only did it break the resistance of the peasant farmer to collectivization, but to a great degree it destroyed Ukrainian rural society, replaced by the Soviet system of collectives. The question emerges, did the average Ukrainian view Ukraine as a colony of Russia, which was robbing them economically? We can answer this question in the affirmative. In conversations recorded by government organs at the end of the 1920s and beginning of the 1930s, farmers stressed that the cause of the famine was the removal of grain from Ukraine to be taken to Russia, or Russia's robbery of Ukraine. Therefore, the Ukrainian peasants placed the main fault for the famine not so much on local communists as on the metropolis. They also used the word colony. Here is one concrete example. In the village of Vodyone in the Mariupol region, one local activist, a Communist Party member, was reported as telling farmers, Ukraine is Russia's colony from which the latter takes bread and taxes. Ukrainians are being strangled mercilessly. The mood among non-party members, especially the better-off population, was even more radical. And these are quotes. How long are we going to be under Russian rule? Asked one of the more affluent peasants in the village, Tarasyuvka. We need to break away from the Moskali, a pejorative term for Russians. It doesn't befit us to live with Russia. We have ample resources, but Moscow takes everything. They take everything from us, those Ruskies, and we Ukrainians are hungry and naked. This cannot go on, end of quote. This is from a reported conversation of a group of mid-level peasant farmers in the Cherkasy region. A report from the Uman region quotes mid-level farmers speaking among themselves as saying, they clear our Ukraine of all its grain and take it to Russia. Russia deceives Ukraine, takes its grain and sugar, but doesn't give finished products in return. And moreover, it tortures us with famine. Authorities in Kharkiv, the capital at the time, were aware of these attitudes and explained them as the Kurkul, the wealthy peasant, Petlerite, nationalist factor. As early as March 1928, the leader of the Republican Communist Party branch, Kaganovich, recognized that the extraordinary measures in Ukraine of grain requisition had caused, quote, increased chauvinism from both above and below. In a speech at the plenary meeting of the Central Committee of the Ukrainian Communist Party, he stated, we hear about conversations that bread and sugar are being taken away to Moscow. Questions about Moscow, about the Soviet Union, to which the economist Volobuyev gave false, despicable answers, are now being aggressively posed by the Kurkul, the parasite farmer. On the same topic, the General Secretary of the Ukrainian Communist Party, Kostyor, said on July 16, 1928, at a meeting of Kharkiv region communist activists, quote, some whisper in Ukraine that grain is supposedly taken away from Ukraine and brought to Moscow. Of course, these rumors are counter-revolutionary Petlerite in origin. Evidently, our enemies are on the attack. We have only begun to study the Ukrainian Holodomor from the perspective of colonialism and imperialism. Here again, we can raise similarities with the Irish case. Their historians did not at first raise the colonial factor in the Irish famine. Initially, the Gortamor of 1845-52 was considered entirely the result of natural factors, while the policies of London were not subject to scrutiny. It was at the beginning of the 1990s that historian Cormac O'Brady in his Famine, A Short History, raised the issue. I would add that the study of the Holodomor through the prism of Soviet imperialism and colonialism is especially poignant today, given the open aggression of Russia against Ukraine. In conclusion, I would like to return to the words of Mark von Hagen. Colonialism may not have contributed any more to the Holodomor in Ukraine in 32-33 than it did in Ireland in 1846-1852 or Bengal in 1943. but the colonial factors certainly created an environment in which the ruling elites introduced policies and used their bureaucratic apparatus to achieve new degrees of dictatorial control. Thank you.
A commentary by Professor von Hagen.
Well, this is perhaps a good midpoint in our afternoon conversation to sort of link what we just heard with what's coming. And as you've heard a few times, the idea for this particular meeting is sort of in between an earlier meeting in Toronto about comparative communism, sort of from the perspective of comparative communism, where China and the Soviet Union were put in sort of a traditional comparative communist, or more traditional comparative communist framework, and a conference that we're planning to do in Kyiv with Liudmyla, and Liudmyla has been kind of talking with me about this for a few years now, and this is a sort of midpoint in which she picked up on something that I said at the Comparative Communism Conference, that one of the traditions that was, what it seems to me that the whole, that several aspects of the Soviet-Ukrainian famine context and the broader Soviet famine that includes also Kazakhstan, raise all sorts of questions about imperialism, colonialism, and how applicable it is to talk about the Soviet system and communist states. And that was, I mean, something that perhaps to those of you who studied the British Empire might seem a strange debate. Why would it be so radical to propose that the Soviet Union was an empire and practice colonial practices? And that was, and it's a good question to ask. And part of it has to do with this sort of the control of the narrative, both in the Soviet Union, where people like the man whose memoir history I'm bringing out in translation, Pavlo Hristiuk, he ended up in the Gulag, and I've been making the case that he's probably one of the first articulate voices of an anti-colonial nationalism coming out of Ukraine and out of the left in the Ukrainian Socialist Revolutionary Party, and he introduces his history as a lesson for the world of all oppressed peoples by race, nationality, and class. So he offers the Ukrainian case already in 1921 when he wrote this book in Vienna, finishing what he started in on the run from the Bolsheviks in Ukraine. He sort of called for what Erez Manella from Harvard in his recent book on the Wilsonian moment calls the origins of anti-colonial nationalism. So this alternative, as we heard with Volobuyev, was also suppressed by the Stalinist state, and not just the people were suppressed, but memory of them was suppressed. Their archives were off limits until fairly recently. So partly this the possibility of talking about Ukraine as a colony in a Soviet empire is the result of 25 years of Ukraine's independence from the Soviet Union. But again, sort of echoing the earlier remarks, the wonderful papers about Irish famine in its historiographical context, the war of the last 2 years, Russia's war with Ukraine, first the annexation of Crimea, and then the support for the pro-Russian insurgents in eastern Ukraine, makes the stories about annexation and colonies and occupations a much more contemporary and much more it makes us go back to earlier experiences that we had thought about in different ways. So in some ways, what I'm proposing here by comparing, by offering to compare the British imperial experience in the 19th century in Ireland and then in the 20th century in India with the Soviet experience in Ukraine in the early half of the 20th century is to suggest that it was possible to imagine an anti-colonial nationalist critique of history and of the revolution and of Soviet power already early, coming out of World War I and the revolution itself, 1917. I mean, as you heard, Hristiuk was an activist and a participant in both the Ukrainian National People's Republic governments under the Rada and then in the Directory period under Petlura. So he saw the revolution. He considered himself a leftist, then a revolutionary, and a socialist to his dying day, and he ended up paying for that in the gulag for the last 7 or 8 years of his life after he returned, for some reason, from Viennese emigration to build the Ukrainian nation in Soviet conditions in Kharkiv. So this, again, the British Empire has been written about as a capitalist empire, and I was glad that, again, Peter, in his talk, talked about something, a capitalist cultural revolution in the minds, at least, of Trevelyan, someone, Trevelyan and Clarendon, someone I've gotten to know better than most Russian historians, I think, because of this interest in the Ukrainian and the Irish famine. And what I think we can see Stalin doing with collectivization is a socialist cultural revolution, an armed socialist cultural revolution that was meant to be as disruptive and transformative of existing conditions as Trevelyan's utopian vision, which was described. So again, the vision did not have its complete realization in Trevelyan's case, probably was more completely realized in the Soviet case, but we're talking about introducing capitalism here, although the sort of cultural revolution that Peter referred to in reference to Trevelyan's vision is very much at the heart of Stalinist utopian transformative visions as well for them. And again, one of the important components of collectivization that it went already together with the building of a carceral state. So the gulag was part of collectivization, as was the sort of war on memory and the war on archives. And so the whole discussion was suppressed for the Soviet period because of those things. And the carceral state, or the gulag system, again, brings us back to another person who was an early comparatist of empires, and that was Hannah Arendt and her sort of classic totalitarianism, the origins of totalitarianism. One of the pillars of totalitarianism was imperialism. And imperialism she identified with the British experience in the Boer War and the creation of the first concentration camps there. And other historians have argued that at a similar period, the Spanish colonial war in Cuba also led to the first creation of carceral institutions that became known as concentration camps and had their consequences in both Nazi Germany and in Stalinist Russia. So we've heard about Mike Davis and his late Victorian Holocaust is another sort of suggestion that something, even though it was not the institution of a capitalist liberal system, a market system through force to a large degree and through the displacement of peasants and farmers, with a kind of ethnic and religious marking of the other. But we also have an opposition movement that's got casted in this way. I also want to put the Ukrainian famine and the Holodomor, which, you know, I don't know if it's some sort of literary, metaphorical creator up there who saw this at some point, but in I've been trained by my Irish historian colleagues to call it the Hortamor, and even the sort of almost poetic Holodomor, Hortamor suggests there's something here at work, both about public memory and about the sort of policies that memory represents. There was a very interesting discussion about how Canadian colonies moved into provinces, and the question was about national sovereignty and dominion having some sort of parliamentary system. And again, this is something that was missing from the Soviet case. I mean, there were sort of paper Soviets and parliaments, but by the late 20s already, there was no possibility of an open, sustained critique of the regime from inside. I mean, and people who did disagree with them paid with their lives or with the long prison sentences or exile. And so the Soviet Union was much more of an imperial colonial dictatorship than the British Empire on several measures. But again, the sort of attitude of the metropole to the periphery, to the colonies, was very similar. And even we talked about the imperial sort of professional careers of Trevelyan moving from India to Ireland and back to India. And this is, I mean, that's the history of Russian imperial servitors, whether in the clergy or in the imperial bureaucracy, in the military. But in the Soviet case, too, that there was a very much a sort of rotating set of imperial elites tied by families and by career paths and by schools who often co-opted members of the oppressed minorities, and so they became, again, part of, like, the Scots and the Irish and the British empire makers themselves. So you have these split identities of Ukrainians as empire builders, but also as empire opposers and empire wreckers, as we had Scots and Irish, and so all of these sort of things are more possible to talk about now, but also I think invite a lot more simplifications and mischaracterizations since the war between Russia and Ukraine of the last 2+ years, and the sort of narrowing space for questioning the sort of national narratives of either Putin in the Russian side or some Ukrainian nationalist version on the other side, which is, I mean, all of them are confused and in information, but the war is impacting what is possible to say and what is not possible to say. So again, I think the Ukrainian case is a nice transition from the Irish case, which we talked about colonialism and whereas the Indian case is, for me, it's the origins of post-colonialism as a sort of way of looking at the world, and Ukrainian historians and literature scholars have appropriated from both of those literatures in very creative ways, seeing much about the South Asian subcontinent's experience in Ireland as informing how they can understand the way Ukraine operated inside the Russian and Soviet empires. And another set of interesting questions that I think we'll continue to have for the next sessions is something that Mark raised about continuing colonialism as an alternative way of talking than post-colonialism, and post-colonialism tends to be associated more with literary scholars, I think, still than sort of more straight historians, and colonialism is something that I think historians still feel more comfortable with than post-colonialism. And I we talked in Peter's paper about stages of Ireland's colonial relationship with England from sort of the early 19th century recolonization introduced sort of a new rewriting of the rules of the relationships between Irish people and English people, however defined, and Irishness and Englishness and Britishness. And again, this is something I think in the case of Ukraine too, we see stages, and for many people, the 1920s, before collectivization, before the sort of consolidation of the Stalinist state, was a period of Soviet decolonization, an attempt to reassert the Ukrainian and Yiddish voice and Yiddish culture, a sort of Soviet version of Austro-Marxism imposed from above without democracy. And so there were stages at which and there was a lot of opposition to this, and it turned out that the Leninist minority, whatever it might be, was indeed a minority, and once a signal was given to allow that the majority who opposed this to come back, it was destroyed ruthlessly. And again, many of the people we were talking about who proposed this sort of critique of Soviet rule already as beginning to look like Russian imperial rule, and who had their careers ended and sometimes their lives ended, this was part of the 1920s and this sort of alternative that was suppressed cruelly, both intellectually and in actual institutional, economic, and cultural form by the Stalinist counter-revolution. So,
okay, that's it.
I can stop. I think I can stop. Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks. Okay. Caused enough troubles.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark. We can now open the floor to questions. You can proceed to the microphone and identify yourself, please. Right. And yes. You're the first to, if you could go to the microphone or.
My question is about whether this whole concept of Russian or Soviet imperialism vis-a-vis Ukraine was something that started with the communist revolution, or does it predate that to the Tsarist period?
Mm-hmm. що Росія колоніальна держава є перед 17-м роком, ще було колонізація.
This has to do with the so-called imperial turn. I mean, I think for the last, again, starting before the end of the Soviet Union in 1991, but certainly in accelerated by the breakup of the Soviet Union and its broader empire, historians who used to think of Russia as a nation-state in formation have rediscovered a lot of historians who were very much more sensitive to Russia being an empire, and that includes, of course, pre-1917. Most interesting work has been done in 18th and 19th century Russian history. And Ukraine, together with Jewish history, together with Tatar history, has been sort of leading the way in getting us to think about Russia as an empire, both in the, from Ivan the Terrible at least, Andreas Koppeler being sort of one of the fathers of the imperial turn in Russian history, who started his career with a study of the absorption, conquest, annexation of the Tatar Khanates under Ivan, and going to the Soviet period. But there was for a long time, even those who were willing to talk about the Russian Empire as an empire, resisted talking about the Soviet Union as an empire because the Soviet Union, among other things, claimed it was the leader of anti-imperialist in the world. And if you were a leftist, among many leftists, you might take that line too and refuse to see it. And that happened in American academia, that people who identified with the more leftist position saw the Soviet Union as incapable of being an empire because capitalism had been abolished. And so that's why I started the argument, but that what this suggestion that the Soviet Union is an empire faces is, where is capitalism and markets in colonialism? As an important, without going back to the econometric arguments, but I think we can talk about empires without the same kind of capitalism that we see in Britain.
Чи сприймали українці як імперію, так? Так. А я хотіла сказати, як сприймали росіяни українців у 20-му році.
Okay, she would like to discuss the problem of how Russians understood Ukrainians in the 1920s.
В 1920 році відбулося збройне завоювання України. Це стало відомо після відкриття архівів національного перепису Червоної армії станом на серпень 20-го року.
Okay, in practice or in reality, 1920 was Russia's conquest of Ukraine. This has become better known since the archive, which I didn't catch quite the name of, that she studies on this.
На території України було введено 800 тисяч росіян, мобілізованих з внутрішніх губерній Росії.
Into Ukraine came, скільки
тисяч? 800 тисяч.
800,000 Russian troops, which were mobilized in the interior of Russia, were brought into Ukraine.
Абсолютно більше цих людей були селяни, і їх симпатії до гасел комунізму були нульові.
Overwhelmingly, these were peasants who were recruited, they had no sympathy towards this system.
І доволі цікаво, що саме в 20-му році совєтська пропаганда, червона пропаганда, проводилася в такому в наступальному імперському дусі.
Already in 1920, the Soviet propaganda took on the nature of a clear imperialist ideology.
З одного боку, це була апеляція до російських офіцерів, котрим пояснювали, що йде процес об'єднання матушки Росії.
Already to the Russian officer class, there was the appeal that this was a way to unite Mother Russia.
Але от найбільш цікаво, що для пересічних вояків пояснення носило такий суто імперський характер. Отже, ми мусимо йти в Україну, тому що там хліб, там паливо, ці ресурси, без яких ми не можемо жити, нам ці ресурси потрібні.
But for the simple people, it was just an open imperial ideology that Ukraine has grain, Ukraine has energy resources, and we need these, and therefore must take them.
І цікаво, що серед документів настрої, коли до пересічного вояка зверталися з питанням «Товариш, зачем ти прийшов в Україну?», можна було почути надзвичайно характерну відповідь, тому що раніше була Росія, Тепер вона поділилася на більшовиків і українців, і ці українці нам жити не дають, бо хліб весь у них.
And when it was asked, why are you going into Ukraine, they said, before there was only Russia, and now there is this division between the Bolsheviks and Ukraine, and they do not give us the bread, the grain that we need to live, therefore we must go there.
Але інші говорили в буквальному сенсі наступно. Ми вас завоювали, тепер давайте нам все, що нам потрібно. Тобто це є документи політуправління робітничо-селянської Червоної армії, зведення звідти.
She finds in the documents of the Red Army these documents which say that we were cut off from these resources and now we have won them, we have conquered them back, what we need.
One other aspect of this is, you talk about Russia as an empire, and again, Russia was an empire, the Soviet Union was an empire, but Ukraine's history is tied up with a few other empires too, especially including the 20th century German ones and Austro-Hungarian ones. What I think we should also put in context that the famine is only one episode in a longer history of imperial occupations and deprivations of freedom and human rights abuses, we would call them today. And I tried to put this in the context also of the German occupation during World War I, the murderous Holocaust-related occupation of Ukraine in World War II. And even today in Ukrainian public memory and collective memory, Chernobyl is considered, and the Soviet-Afghan war are considered the last sort of Soviet acts of colonial rule before the end of the Soviet Union. So Chernobyl as another kind of famine, a natural disaster with trauma related to it, and also government responses and government mismanagement and incompetence and sort of longer generational attitudes and stereotypes about Ukraine and Ukrainians and Belarus again with the other what historians are now calling national indifference, that you have such a long sort of period of trauma resulting from these colonial episodes of mismanagement or rule, that you have a national indifference which leads people in Belarus as the most extreme example who find it difficult to have a positive national self-identity that they feel would justify having a national independence as an economy with some sort of economic and political self-sufficiency. So it's part of a, again, bigger traumatic sort of psychological problem that we talked about with the Irish famine as well. And the famine is only one episode in the 20th century of colonial rule and misrule and alien rule, however we might call it. So,
any further questions, comments? Identify yourself, please, before speaking.
My name is John Shetichka from the University of Northern Colorado. So my question is, when we talk in terms of colonialism and empire, I wonder what happens to the social narratives, the stories of everyday people. So my question is, in what ways can we use Holodomor survivor testimony to construct more developed narratives of everyday life during the famine in the context of colonialism and empire?
Повсякденних життя до того часу. Коли сьогодні я говорила про про настрої, повсякдення людей було пов'язано з тим, що нищили їх господарства, нищили економіку, нищили родину. І ми сьогодні говорили, як це сприймалося, якщо в документах ОГПУ, де збиралися лише характерні, найвиразніше свідчення, вказується на те, що в українському суспільстві в різних регіонах вирувала думка про те, що біди України пов'язані з її колоніальним статусом і пов'язані з визиском імперії, причому вони наносили такі, то це є відповідь на запитання, як це ми можемо
She has given the examples from the secret police archive, which, after all, are recounting their views of what is being said by the population. And as she had in a number of illustrations shown, they connected the destruction of their family, their life, the starvation, to this issue of whence it came. And in that sense, from a colonial center, so she has given a number of examples from the sources that she has, and those are the sources available. To the microphone, if you're going to ask a question, please. Okay, and this will have to be the last question, I'm afraid, yeah.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Manley from Queen's University. Thank you, it was a very interesting talk. I wondered, in the first panel, there was a lot of discussion by both the speaker and the commentator on contemporary comparative examples. And I wondered if you could comment on how you would see the simultaneous famines taking place in other Soviet regions within this context. You provided a very interesting interpretive framework for understanding the Ukrainian famine in a colonial term. How do you bring in the Volga regions, the North Caucasus, Kazakhstan?
На мою думку, якраз давайте говорити про економіку. Я вам просто проілюструю це, наприклад, на матеріалах голоду 28-29 року, котрий прекрасно задокументований.
She would like to do a comparison with the famine of 1928-29, for which there is very good documentation.
І цей випадок 28-29 року, безперечно, ми можемо це реконструювати по відношенню 32-33, тому що там процеси дуже близькі і надзвичайно схожі, практично тотожні.
Because on this better documentation, one can understand many of the processes which then repeated in the 1932-33 famine.
Отже, в країні зернова криза, зумовлена недородом. В країні бракує хліба.
There is a general lack of grain because there are problems with the harvest, and this is a general phenomenon.
Що робить уряд? Є два варіанти вирішення питання. Перший. Якщо в цілому в країні бракує хліба, його завозять всередину, тобто експортують. Але якщо всередині країни хліба достатньо, його перерозподіляють між регіонами.
That if there is a lack in the center, then they would take grain in this situation to the center. But if there's a general problem throughout the country, they would then distribute these resources throughout these regions.
Ми маємо кілька землеробських регіонів, але є величезна різниця між Україною і іншими регіонами, скажімо, Росією. В Україні надзвичайно легко брати хліб внаслідок того, що вона повністю вкрита залізничними шляхами.
Okay, there is a differentiation between how this distribution occurs throughout in most of the regions of Russia and in Ukraine, where in Ukraine these resources could be distributed along these train routes.
І також є переконання влади центральної в тому, що Україна мусить годувати райони півночі, котрі інтенсифікуються. Тобто є переконання того, хліба в Україні нема, але є переконання в того, що цей хліб є, і його можна взяти і вивезти в ті регіони, де є криза хлібна.
Okay, there is a conviction with the government that there is grain in Ukraine and that this grain can be taken to the northern, in this case, meaning Russian regions, where it is needed for their intensification of the economy.
В цей час спостерігається голод в Україні і в інших регіонах Росії. Але з України вивозять 130 мільйонів пудів хліба, з них лише дрібниця йде на експорт, абсолютна більшість хліба йде на терен Російської Федерації.
130 million puds of grain are then taken from Ukraine. Almost a very little bit was for export and overwhelmingly for the feeding of the Russian Republic.
Наступає літо, в Україні масштабний неврожай, і починається масштабний голод. Здавалося б, якби була нормальна, адекватна політика, тепер хліб з врожайних регіонів треба привозити в Україну. Правда?
Okay, so when there is this problem in Ukraine, it would seem that when you have this lack of a harvest in Ukraine, they would have brought this grain into Ukraine.
В Україну завозять 13 мільйонів пудів хліба з Росії і тихенько вивозять 10.
But what they do instead is they bring in 13 million puds of grain into Ukraine and they take out 10, so that are leaving.
Чубар, голова Раднаркому України, пише листа про те, що колапс в українській економіці спричиняють масові вивезення хліба на північ.
Чубар, head of the government, writes saying that in this situation, why are they taking out this amount of grain out of Ukraine?
А про настрої людей я вам вже сьогодні трошки говорила. І тепер я можу абсолютно впевнено говорити про те, що, напевно, причиною голоду в інших регіонах Росії в 32-33 році значною мірою було те, що імперська влада просто зарізала золоту курку, котра несла ті яйця. Розумієте, якщо Україна, на неї накладали хлібозаготівлю 52% союзних заготівель, при тому, що вона, її відсоток сільського господарства – це 18%. Це означає, що ця територія фактично була знекровлена, пограбована, вона почала гинути, але і ті, хто годувався за рахунок цих територій, так само почали потерпати.
Okay, I cannot recreate all of these numbers that were given, but Ukraine was the golden goose, and they had killed the golden goose, and hence this is why one got these problems in much of Russia. Kazakhstan.
No, no, Kazakhstan.
Just a couple words on Kazakhstan, and I'm glad again Peter and Mark reminded us that there were different reactions to the famine already in Scotland at the same time and in Canadian provinces. But again, in the case of Soviet Union, Kazakhstan had a different set of consequences resulting from the fact that most of the population was still nomads and herders and had to be sedentarized, and that was the cause of their greatest losses, was that they were being forced from a more nomadic existence into something more, so like what they did with the gypsies in Roma and other periods. So within this sort of broader Moscow-centered policy of collectivization, there could be different consequences and different even tactics in achieving their goals that reflected local conditions and different ideas from the center of what the local conditions made appropriate or inappropriate. So, I mean, I don't think we need to assume that the colonialism has any kind of a genetic code that immediately produces the same answer everywhere. Okay. It's not that easy. So,
fortunately, you have in your packets information on our journal where we dealt with China and Kazakhstan. I think what you will find there, it was largely the requisitions of meat products for Moscow and Leningrad, not the sedentarization of the Kazakhs that led to the massive famine and explain the tremendous percentage of deaths among Kazakhs. So you have that in there. It'll soon appear in print, but you can already, those of you who like online, can do it that way. We are well over into your coffee break, and you have to come back at 3:30. I will only make two comments in payment for my translation. First of all, it was common in Poland in the 1930s, definitely, and maybe as early as the 1920s, to say that the Soviet Union is really a radish. It's only red on the outside, it's white within. And many Western Ukrainians thought in those categories. And that brings us to one element that also has to be looked at. The colonial discussion of the Soviet Union and the famine as colonial already occurs in the Ukrainian diaspora in the 1930s. So this is how Ukrainians abroad were interpreting what was going on in Ukraine. So it's a very old tradition of discussing it as colonial. And
я вже дуже коротко, просто я хотіла сказати, що для нас надзвичайно є зрозумілими і перспективними дуже серйозні дослідження стану економічного в російських регіонах. Саме тому наші демографи, скажімо, зараз вивчають досить успішно ситуацію саме в російських регіонах. Але навіть побіжний перегляд документів вказує, що існувала величезна різниця в оподаткуванні, тобто з України брали більше. Бюджет, з українського бюджету тягнули більше, ніж з інших регіонів. В хлібозаготівлях, в планах, розумієте? Тобто цей момент, він настільки є очевидним, що залишається лише дивуватися. Чому протягом десятиліть ми постійно ходимо довкола лише політичних моментів, а економіки не бачимо? Хоч в ній основа.
The argument is that if one looks at the Russian laws for taxation, for taking of these products in comparison with the Ukrainian, they're quite different and much more difficult for Ukraine. And she says that perhaps we who have studied the Holodomor have paid too much attention to politics and not really looked at the economic factors that bring this about. And there she sees a differentiation between Ukraine and Russia. And with this, we thank you. Thank you for your attention. Yes, you have 12 minutes. Okay.